I want to first introduce our guest speakers. We have Ashley Parsons from Acadia, who's going to be talking a little bit about how she used Beyond Labs in her general chemistry courses. And then we have Peter Norris as well from Youngstown State, who is also going to be sharing how he used Beyond Labs recently in his organic courses. So I have here just on the screen our agenda for today. I'm just introducing us now. We're going to hear from Ashley first, and then we're going to hear from Peter afterwards. After we hear from our guest speakers, we're going to hear from Dr. Brian Woodfield, who's one of the founders at Beyond Labs. He's going to share a little bit about our new HTML5 version of the labs. We'll be releasing this August and get a sneak peek of that. And then at the end, if we have some time, we'll open to questions for the Beyond Labs team and also to our guest speakers. I'm going to go ahead and turn the time over to Ashley to do her presentation first.
What does that look?
I can see it.
Okay, I was saying this is one of my very first times using Zoom because we use Teams at my university, so I'm not exactly a pro. Hi, I'm Ashley, and I'm an instructor in the chemistry department at Acadia University. So we're located in the Annapolis Valley, and that's in Nova Scotia, Canada. And if you don't know too much about Nova Scotia, I think you probably know one of our number one exports is Sidney Crosby. So that was an important export to the US. So this time last year, our university started thinking about their decision for the fall, and eventually they decided that we would have a hybrid modality. So it just meant that it was up to the faculty member whether or not they would be teaching 100% online or maybe some combination of in-person or online. So after thinking about it, I decided in the fall to go with my general chemistry labs being online asynchronous. And then in the winter, I turned it over to still being online, but we went in a synchronous mode. So just an idea about, to give you an idea about Acadia, we're primarily an undergraduate university. So I do have 17 TAs I did in the fall, and they were all undergrads. And in the fall, our numbers were a little bit lower than usual, and I had about 300 students, and I decided to use Beyond Labs 100%. So I had a little bit of my material on the go, some of my videos, but 100% I was using Beyond Labs, and I would have some virtual office hours and help sessions, and they were happening daily. And then in the winter, we lost quite a few students, so we're down to about 200, 16 TAs, and we were using Beyond Labs about 30% of the time. So up until last September, I didn't have any experience teaching virtual chemistry labs. I probably would have said, okay, this is not a thing. But I also didn't have any experience teaching online either. So if you look at my LMS from even last year, I probably just would have had some PowerPoint slides and a schedule, and that's all that I would have had. So I did have to learn quite a bit starting last April, last May. I attended a few webinars like this one, for example, but pretty much I knew that I wanted the students to be acquiring their own data in some way. And I felt that way back in April and May of last year, and I still feel that way. I think it's really important that they have that ability. I did review a few different simulations, and I was interested in seeing what kind of content they could provide, because I really didn't want to be reinventing the wheel, and I was thinking about going back in September and how much work it was going to be. So one thing that I did was I watched a webinar, and that was a virtual CIC webinar. So if you are a member of the CIC, you would have access to that, but I have the instructor's name up on the screen, and she was talking about her experience with Beyond Labs, and she was giving a few tips and tricks, so I thought that was very, very valuable. And then an instructor who actually taught me at CBU, which is in Nova Scotia, she had some really good feedback. She had gone through it with a smaller class in her spring intersession. So normally what I would do is I would have a lab manual. So the students get their lab manual every term, and then they're filling out their data, observations, calculations, for each particular experiment and then handing that to me at the end of the particular lab. And then once per term, they would do a formal written lab report. So there I was thinking, okay, I need to be preparing all of these report sheets from scratch for the Beyond Labs experiments, but they were already provided in the student manual. And then the other thing that I would have during my lab time would be a grading scheme or just a grading key for me and for the TAs, and Beyond Labs was providing that in their instructor manual, so I could make that connection right away. So like I mentioned, the webinar, the trial versions that I was able to play around with for I think weeks and weeks at a time, and then all the communications from especially Kelsey and Heather and Brian, and then the price was really competitive too. So those were a lot of the reasons why we decided to go with Beyond Labs at Acadia. And I should mention too, we also bought licenses for the organic labs. That instructor was really impressed with Beyond Labs as well. So the labs ran over a 10-week period in the fall term. So I'll just focus on the fall term. And so I have experiments here, 1 through 5, and these were all the presets that were given from Beyond Labs. And so each experiment, I'm calling them an A and a B part, but really they are experiments on their own. And the A experiment is just highlighted. I called that more of the featured experiment, and that's what the students would have a quiz on. So each experiment, the A and B part, they would last for 2 weeks. The students were given all of the content a few days before that 2 week period would start. And then on the last Friday of that 2 week period, they would pass in their report sheet and they'd pass in their notebook. But just for example, for experiment number one on September 28th, they would write a quiz. Everyone would write a quiz. All right, so I was on, slide 3. Okay, so I was just listing all of the 5 experiments, the A and B parts, and just mentioning that over that 2 week period on day one, you would give, I would give my quiz, and then they would have the 2 weeks to work on those particular experiments. So I think originally going into my setup for the fall, I was thinking about in the 2 week period, give the students 3 experiments, but just by default, what happened was during week one, they would only work on experiment 1A. And during week two, they would only work on experiment 1B, and it was just their way of sort of checking things off. And the TAs also appreciated it too, because they knew exactly what questions were coming. So what I did was in summertime, I had access to the student manual. So within the student manual, the procedure is provided, as well as those post-lab questions. So I was taking that document and just editing that as I needed to, and providing that to the students. And I would just refer to it as the procedure. So I'd refer to it as the procedure. I'd post that up on our LMS site. And then once they filled in their answers and gave it back to me, we would just call that a report sheet. So the procedure was empty, report sheet was filled in with all their information. And then as far as the TAs and myself, we're looking for that answer key from day to day. So the instructor manual had all that information already. So we use Teams at Acadia. So I was preparing that document and just posting that up on Teams. As far as LMS, this is a look at what's happening on mine. So like I mentioned before, last September, it would have been pretty empty, but I just made sure at the very top of LMS, everything that the students need for Beyond Labs was there. So all of the instructions are there, their activation code was there, there's a video there as well on how to set things up. And then I had the support website there, and just, you know, okay, go ahead, go to the site, click more help if you have any questions. And that pretty much reminds me that within the first few weeks, I started noticing, okay, they have some questions about getting things going, but those questions are pretty much all the same. So on my discussion board, directly onto Acorn with the TAs, I just sort of set up a quick little blurb that we'd be ready to send to the students if they had an issue. So it was sort of like, try this, If that doesn't work, try this. And if that doesn't work, go ahead and contact the support team. And I think somewhere around September or October, Heather gave me a sort of estimate about how long it's taking to get back to the students. So I just made sure to include that as well, so they wouldn't be deterred and, you know, thinking, okay, I won't bother ask for any help. So it was, you know, things like 30 minutes to a couple of hours, right? So that was really encouraging for them to know that. And as far as the week to week with the experiments, this is what my LMS looked like. So I'm just mentioning, okay, I have an experiment 2, A and B. There's the titles of those experiments. I'm providing them below. They're just referred to as experiment 2, A and B procedures. I tell them for experiment number 2, you have to take a quiz and the date. For that quiz, you want to review your PowerPoint slides and your procedures. And then below, just talking about when everything would be due. And you can see at the very bottom, I'm just giving the link to the quiz, your procedures, here's your slides. And then I have 2 Turnitin assignments. That's what we refer to them as at Acadia. And you can see where the students are submitting their report sheets and where they're submitting their notebook. So again, everything would be scanned for plagiarism through those links. But the TAs are also able to do their grading through the Turnitin Feedback Studio. And I didn't mention the notebook already, but what I was asking them to do was to take their data, to take their observations from the Beyond Labs lab and make up a Microsoft Word document. So it was looking a lot like their lab books would in the Gen Chem lab. Table of contents, all the pages are numbered, but then for every experiment, they're having their data, their observations, and their calculations. And then I don't have any sort of direct links to my videos, but what I did before getting started was I made my first YouTube channel. And on that, when it was safe to do so, I went back into the lab and I made some videos about safety, just a general tour of the lab. I went through and did either the same reaction that was coming up in Beyond Labs or a similar reaction. And I was trying to showcase some techniques. So in most of the videos, it is me. In some, we have some TAs, but I thought that connection between seeing me on video and teaching the course was important. And then also, so it was a really great stepping off point for some really good conversations with the students. So those videos were letting them make the connection between what's happening with Beyond Labs and what happens in person. So I think that's all that I wanted to share, and Kin just mentioned everyone that's here, the great team, that it was a great experience at Acadia, and we really enjoyed it. And I guess the best way to show that is to sign up again. And I just mentioned to Kelsey that we're interested in using it for the spring session as well.
Great, thank you, Ashley, that was awesome.
Thank you. Sorry about the technical difficulty there.
No, that's totally all right. We got it worked out, so we're good to go. Thanks again. So we'll move over to Peter now. Again, if you have any questions for us, feel free to put them in the chat or the Q&A. Don't forget to do the poll as well. And we'll turn the time over to Peter.
Hey, thanks, Kelsey, for the introduction. I'm going to share a screen. Hopefully everybody can see this. I'm at Youngstown State. It's in the northeast of Ohio. In America, it's referred to the Rust Belt. We are the buckle in the Rust Belt. We are between Pittsburgh and Cleveland. Old industrial town, 12,000 students. So I had the good luck to inherit the lab situation at YSU last spring before COVID shows up. So we had to solve that problem pretty quickly. Let's talk about what guidelines we used. American Chemical Society is our accreditation body. So we had to dive into there and find out what they would do for us and what we were allowed to do. And they were very sensible with their recommendations about trying to do as much as you can online and basically keeping people safe. So we typically have 230 students a semester in about 15 different lab sections, but we don't have much space. So what happened was we had to solve that problem. We have one room for organic chemistry. It holds 16 people. So if you have space, social distancing guidelines, we really couldn't do that. 230 students into 16 HUDs at 8 at a time just doesn't work. We had some new TAs who were kind of naive and kind of new at this. So we had to decide pretty quickly what we were going to do. As everybody else at that time, we sort of looked around, we found some nice simulations from places like Cal Poly Pomona, TLC simulations, stuff like that. And we brought that into the course. We did some kitchen experiments for things like recrystallization or solubility. That was pretty straightforward. But then we had that big problem at the end. What do you do about synthesis? How do you do synthesis in remote and online? So we thought about kids buying glassware, expensive, dangerous possibly, doing experiments at home. Could we record some videos? We could do that, but it gets a bit boring after a while. And then we started to investigate simulation apps. And of course, then Beyond Lab shows up. And I spent the time thinking about this as a forward-thinking thing, because now I'm in charge of labs. I want to change some things. And I was teaching the course in the spring, and then I was teaching all of the organic sequence in the summer because nobody else was interested. And I thought, well, Beyond Labs could be used in this environment, and we could use it in the future. So that was the approach we took. And I put together two semesters full of curriculum where we teach organic one and two at the same time, a trailer sequence in the spring and the fall. And we have to cycle 230 students through those lab classes. So what we tried to do here was set up a sort of a sequence as we would in person about learning about techniques, learning about what organic chemistry is about, how do we purify stuff, how do we isolate stuff, and then build up the workflow. Most organic experiments are the same when you go into a research lab. You put things together, you monitor them, you work out if the reaction's finished, you isolate stuff, and then you purify it, and then you characterize it. So we're trying to build a workflow for the students to grab a hold of. So I'll talk about some of those experiments we did, particularly with Beyond Labs. And then the more challenging part of this was going to be the synthesis component. How do we do that? Now, in my class, I tried to keep my lecture and my lab in sequence. We require the students to take the lab and the lecture at the same time so that they are learning the lecture material and the lab material together. So we see the application because it is very much a practical subject. So I have two semesters worth of this stuff. Again, thinking about using this in the future. So this is going to be used again. All of our stuff is run through Blackboard. We had five different teaching assistants, and we ran all of our labs through Zoom. So the teaching assistant would lead the lab. We'd have a group of 16 students on camera, and they were asked to share their screen as they were doing the work. And so they would have Beyond Labs running in the background. They would be trying experiments out. And if they had a question, they could ask the TA through the chat box, or the TA periodically would make sure that they were doing their own work by asking them to share the screen. And it worked out very nicely. And that worked out especially well, for example, in office hours, where doing Zoom office hours, the student would have a problem and said, well, this didn't work in lab. Can you help me with it? So they would have their Beyond Labs open on the screen and they'd show me what they were doing. And I'd point out, this is going wrong. This is what you're doing wrong. You forgot to do this. You missed this out. It was very good in terms of them getting their problems solved efficiently and quickly. When you're dealing with big numbers at these types of schools, kids can get lost in the crowd. And this is a nice way to solve that problem. So what we did was we built this two semester curriculum based on the usual sequence that we use. And first off, we do online work using something called Molview, which is a free modeling package. And it's just a website. And you type in the name of the compound, the students get back a stretcher. They can do some rudimentary molecular modeling and get used to hybridization patterns, get used to shapes of molecules, as we are doing in lecture. And part of the problem with new students in a class is that they don't know where to go for reliable information. So instead of Wikipedia, you know, or Uncle Bob said this, we teach them to go through things like PubMed through the National Library of Medicine. And they were getting very good at this. They now know where to go to pick up reliable information that is going to be valid. So this was good. We had pre-labs written. The students would come to lab at their assigned time. The TA would lead them, through the labs. They'd have a PowerPoint presentation to show what they're going to do through the day. And then through the 3-hour session, the students would get the lab done. And at the end of the day, instead of having a notebook, we would have them upload to Blackboard what they did on the day. And that was kind of a timestamp of what they'd achieved in that particular session. And then they would take that data home and they would put together a full report. And we did full reports for every single experiment. I'm not sure this was the best idea. We probably wore them out, but they did it and most of the kids got through. So this is an example of the beginning. This is solubility. We did some solubility kitchen experiments with some basic cooking materials. And then we did this where we chose a group of compounds from Beyond Labs that exemplified different functional groups and different polarities of the molecules. And then we borrowed from the qualitative analysis section some of the solvents that were available. Now, sodium iodide and acetone, we used acetone as a solvent. We ignored the sodium iodide and we chose some of the substrates that would not react with sodium iodide. And this worked. So aqueous sodium hydroxide and also aqueous HCl are setting up for the extraction experiment, where their knowledge and solubility has to be taken forward to then think about a separatory funnel experiment and then deciding where the material is going to go in terms of the set funnel. So this was great because it's the first introduction to Beyond Labs that they saw. It's in the qualitative analysis section, which is stripped down and easier to use than the synthesis section. So we got them started here and they were able to take materials from the shelf and put them into flasks. And then the very clever videos were really well received, that they can see the actual dissolution as things go. So I put together a few little videos here about how we use this. This was basically get used to how the workflow, or how I should say the actual Beyond Labs work. How do you use the spatula to put material in the flask? How do you get it onto the stir plate? And then we borrowed sodium iodide and acetone. You can see dissolution. The students took screenshots to record this material, then put it into their lab reports. And this was great because we could then change things up. They were getting used to how this worked. We took benzoic acid as a simple example. And thinking again about organic moving into the separatory funnel work and thinking about extractions, if they use aqueous HCl, it should not dissolve, it doesn't. So that was nice and they can see that. But then if they do the last experiment here, which was, I believe, using sodium hydroxide, they're gonna get chemistry. And at this point in the lecture, they're learning about acids and bases. And now all of a sudden they're doing an acid-base reaction in a solubility experiment, as we would do in person. And they have to answer the question, why is this stuff dissolving? So now we're getting some chemistry as well as the physical process, and it's building up to what comes next and what in a little bit here, which is the idea of extraction. So this was good. This is a nice way to get started. And I think I'll be using something like this in the future to set them up for actual actual work in the lab. So we also build then into an extraction type thing. This is still solubility and miscibility. We've got ether on the shelf, we've got ethanol, we've got water, we've got some different polarities, we've got polar aprotic and polar protic as we would in the organic lab. And we started thinking about how can we make the students get this idea of miscibility and solubility in preparation for extraction. So they have the three solutions at the front and they were given a bunch of compounds just to play with. For example, here's benzoic acid, and see what happens and find out where your compound goes in the aqueous layer, because that's always a problem for kids. They can't visualize where things are if both the layers are colorless. So this worked very nicely. Again, they had to think about why a salt goes into the aqueous layer, even if it's an organic compound. Now, we talked about crystallization, and crystallization, in my experience, is always done badly. Students just don't understand crystallization. So we wanted to take our time here and give them something to think about. We did a kitchen crystallization of salt and table sugar, and you could tell there was, you know, lack of patience and they weren't really getting the idea. Some did really well, but some not, which was in line with what we always see in the lab. So then we also decided to do a Beyond Labs experiment. We didn't really care about the chemistry at this point because we hadn't covered it. It was the process. How do you get your stuff out of your flask? So this was okay. This was something that we did for recrystallization. They got used to the crystallizing dish. They got used to the melting point apparatus and recording what they did. So we're building up and they're recording their data and getting used to how this all works. So extraction and distillation, again, somewhat confusing, somewhat difficult to do online, but we did some kitchen stuff with cooking oil and salt and butter, and they reported this and it was fun and it was okay. But then we decided that Beyond Labs would be useful for getting used to for synthesis. So for example, in the extraction experiment, we've just borrowed from what we did with solubility, and we gave them some compounds to play with, and they got different compounds all mixed up and they were to report what happened. And then for the distillation, that was fairly straightforward because we just quenched phenyl magnesium bromide from the Grignard experiment that gave us benzene, and we distilled benzene. So you've got now this buildup and they're used to that equipment, all in little segments without all doing it at once and getting lost. They've done this in individual segments and now they're starting to understand what's happening. So then it started to get fun. TLC, I love the TLC in Beyond Labs. I think it's really clever. I think it really works. In terms of polarities, in terms of purification, in terms of analysis, we linked everything. We didn't use a textbook this year. We linked everything to LibreTex out in California online. They have some really, really nice pages that explain all these techniques. And we borrowed from different places about how TLC works. But then we had them think about RF and think about polarities, how that relates to where the compound was shown on a TLC plate. So we did this in Beyond Labs, and we were able to run, in this case, a random experiment, the nitration of benzaldehyde. We hadn't done the chemistry yet, but they can start to see now that TLC tells me there's something in that flask, and it gives them an idea of relative polarity of what's in that flask. And they can start thinking maybe about where things are going to go when I do that workup. So this was great. This worked nicely, and the students seem to enjoy this because now all of a sudden they're seeing it put together. They're seeing the greater whole. At the end of the first term, we're ready for synthesis. We are thinking now about doing the SN1, the SN2, the E1, the E2. I'll talk about reports in a second. I do have reports coming up. Somebody's asked a question about reports. These are classic reactions that are done in the first semester at the end to get students ready for the second semester. So we wanted to do them in the lab. And this was a great experience because the students had to think. We did some directed reactions where we said, go do this, and what do you see? And towards the end of the term, we started taking the leash off and said, you know, just go find out and start experimenting. And you cannot do that in an undergraduate lab, at least with TAs doing this. So this worked very nicely. I'll give you one example of a sheet that we did, one example of a reaction that we have here, and we're ready to go. So this is my worksheet for alkyl halides. I did, again, you know, I appreciated having the set up labs from Beyond Labs, but we are thinking of using this again in our curriculum for the future. So I wrote them all myself. And we decided that, yeah, let's do some multi-step stuff. Let's turn alcohols into alkyl halides. Let's turn alkyl halides into organic products. Start building this idea of synthesis. So we, at this stage, started to recognize that, well, one of the big things about doing stuff online is safety and the lack of appreciation of safety in an organic lab. So we had to build something in here that would go wrong. And boy, can things go wrong if you set it up right. So reactions of alcohols. We have chlorinating agents on the front bench, right? So here I've got the chlorinating agent. I'm going to take cyclohexanol, going to put it in my flask, I'm going to put some polyaprotic solvent in like ether, put it on the front bench. And I'm going to use ALCL3. It's a catalyst for Friedel-Crafts alkylations. But when you put it together like this, boom, it blows up. Why does it blow up? Well, the ALO bond is so strong, it's very ectothermic. So then the students play around with this and start recognizing that it isn't as sort of straightforward as they think. It's not just click, click, click. It's click and think. So they drag this again to the start, to the front bench. They're going to add, in this case, SOCl2, which is a universal halogenating agent for organic materials. But we made mistakes. They forgot to put the needle on. SO2 is a gas, right? It blows up. So they learn the mistakes and then they fix them. They have to explain what the mistake was. And then finally, of course, if we run this with SOCl2 at room temperature with a vent, we have no problem whatsoever, and we get a nice reaction. And you can see on the right-hand side, the TLC again shows the relative polarities of these things in a very nice way, which students start to appreciate. All right, so somebody asked the question about reports. What did we do? I probably overdid it, to be honest with you. These kids are stressed, but they succeeded. We asked them to do a report for everything they did. And in the first semester, it's worth 10 points each report. And in my class, in the second semester, it's worth 20 points. This is the data table that the kids would typically put together before they did a lab. These are the compounds they were told they were going to be using. They went to PubChem, and they found all the melting points, the boiling points. They found all of the safety data information, and they put it together into this. So no, it's not. We're not just filling in blanks. We're actually writing reports. And these got better and better as the term went on. Then the students would be writing procedures, third person past tense, all this stuff. This took a while to get them used to it because they came from general chemistry, not to put anything against general chemistry, but at our place, they were doing fill-in sheets. They would just hand something in, that was it. Here, we're trying to teach them how to do professional reports. So at the top, we've got the procedure, very nicely done, organized. At the bottom, we've got the evidence, we've got some consideration, we've got screenshots of Beyond Labs as evidence for what they did. And then they had to put together their preferred protocols. This was something that we really enjoyed doing, was preferred protocols. How do you think we're going to do this? Or what is the best method for doing this? Then at the bottom, conclusions. You know, every lab report should contain a conclusion. And they got better and better as the year went on, which is really nice. So then the Organic 2 syllabus. This is the class that I'm teaching right now in lecture. And I wanted to set this up so everything would be parallel. So in the first week, we did reduction of carbonyls in lecture. Now they're doing a reduction of carbonyls in lab. And we set this up. The way I've got it set up here is a couple of weeks of synthesis. And then in the textbook, we go into spectroscopy and spectrometry. Of course, Beyond Labs is going to be useful for that. And then we finished up with a whole bunch of reactions that are classic at the end doing synthesis. But the goal here was to get people thinking on their own. So towards the end of this, when I show you some examples, the students have to design the experiment. I've never been able to do that at the sophomore level. The students now have to put together, they have to do retrosynthesis, they have to think about what they're going to do on the day, and they have to do it, which is really powerful. So let's talk about an example here. This is the IRMS type material that we did with the qualitative analysis part of Beyond Labs, where we're looking at functional groups. And think, you know, I'm going to date myself here, but we're spoiled these days by instrumentation, and students don't appreciate wet chemistry from the past, right? And in many places, we don't do those test tube experiments anymore, which we did when I was a kid, but this was the ability, this was the chance to do both of them. So the first part of this was IRMS and qualitative analysis. We gave them a bunch of different compounds to work with from the chalkboard and a bunch of different tests to do. Some are negative, some are positive, and they would write their observations down. And then just an example here, this is methylcyclohexene. We're going to do a fairly simple bromination test. Obviously, that's a test for the presence of an alkene. And the actual visualization of this was brilliant. The fact that it disappears, the fact that the color dissipates over a few minutes here is brilliant, because then they can see it happen. Instead of just being told it's happening or reading about it, they see it happen. And that was great, because now all of a sudden they have a positive test for an alkene. And if they throw this together, maybe with, it's the same alkene, maybe they put some HCl in, or they put some sodium hydroxide in, it doesn't mix because they're not compatible. They can see this, right? They have something to grab a hold of. So that was great. And they really started to enjoy that. And then we moved into doing the actual spectroscopy. Infrared spectra, I love the fact that the database is huge. I think there are 700 and some spectra in there. So one of the problems I've always got in organic chemistry at the sophomore level is getting eyes on spectra, is getting kids to have spectra in front of them to recognize they don't all jump around, signals don't move. This is reliable and this is predictable. And this really worked. So we got all this data back, and the students again are writing reports. It was a two-part report on the day, and then a later submission for the rest of the grade. Here's the outcome. This is again a student's input, where we have all the positive tests or negative tests, and then we have on the right what happened, and then at the end of the report, why things happened. So it really worked for us. In terms of the spectroscopy part of it, we're interested in key signals for the most part at this level. So we're looking at IR spectra for functional groups, mass spectra, we're looking at the M plus and the base signal. So they were able to collect those pieces of information and then fill this in. So this was something they had to come up with. We led them to do tables, and they were able to put tables together quite nicely, where all of this now is looking at spectra. And we test them on that in the lecture part of the course. So this helps with that. NMR, again, we're spoiled. We have two 400 megahertz NMR spectrometers at my fingertips at work, but we need to give the students historical perspective. And we chose a bunch of different samples to play with, and they did the functional group tests again, and then they decided, then they went ahead and did the spectra. So this is just cinnamaldehyde. You know, it's full of wonderful signals, doublets and what have you. Using the NMR spectrometer in this situation with the qualitative analysis was great, because it was simplified. They got used to looking at the spectra, and then we'd ask them to interpret the spectra for the report. And they could switch the nucleus very quickly, which I think is genius. You can see the signals, you can expand the spectra, and the students have to look at spectra and analyze them, which is really what we're trying to get done there at that part of the class. So that worked very well. And then they would report this type of data. And because we'd all mixed up the compounds, not everybody had the same data, so we sort of minimized the collaboration. And that was good. And again, the reports became very, very impressive. So at the end of this, my last example is the go do it yourself type of assignment, where we're giving them three different compounds. We were just done with the Claisen and the Aldol reactions. So A is a Claisen, is a Claisen condensation, B is a Canavan-Algol reaction, and D is a crossed Aldol reaction. And the students weren't told how to do this. It says down at the bottom, the guidance was you choose the solvents, you choose the starter materials, go do it. And they did. For the most part, they got it done, which was great. So then at the end of that, we can see now they have to choose from the different parts of the chalkboard. They're not guided where they need to go. They go find it themselves. They experiment. If it doesn't work, if you use LDA as the wrong base, it doesn't work. If you use the wrong solvent, it doesn't work. And it took a couple of hours for people to get this all to come together. But the feedback I got was great. People thought it was wonderful because they got to play around. They got to experiment with stuff. TLCs again showing the output. And at this stage now, they know how to use Beyond Labs. And they're starting to think like chemists. They're starting to think that sometimes things go wrong. I can fix that. I can experiment. And I'm not just doing what we describe as cookbook chemistry. I'm thinking. So then this is what I've sort of concluded from this whole experience. I don't want to teach in my basement anymore, but we're going to go back on campus next week and get into it again. But Beyond Labs gave us a chance to solve that problem. You know, we're chemists, we're problem solvers. Beyond Labs helped me solve that problem. We got the organic labs done under difficult circumstances. Students were definitely able to understand the workflow of what organic chemistry experiments are about. Experimentation was possible, which just isn't possible with undergrads. It's dangerous. And a lot more critical thinking. And a lot less cookbook chemistry, a lot less just go through the motions, a lot more thinking. The availability of that qualitative analysis module is wonderful, because you do get that historical perspective of, you know, Woodward won a Nobel Prize without an NMR spectrometer way back. And now we're spoiled with NMR spectrometers, right? But we need to understand that perspective. And then students were pushed to design their own experiments. You don't get to do that very often. And then last thing I want to say is what we're going to do with this going forward. We're definitely using this from now on. I've got all my sheets ready to go. And we're going to use this in the summer and the fall. And we're going to use Blackboard to organize everything because I think it really helps. And then Beyond Labs, definitely for some pre-lab and post-lab work as an add-on to what we're doing in person. And then certainly the Spectra and the qualitative analysis part gives us some things that we would struggle with otherwise. Online final exams that we've been given, again, let's give them a task. Go do this. You have an hour to make this molecule. Go do it. That's something we couldn't do otherwise. And then I'm going to be bringing the actual videos into my lecture class, which is not something I hadn't thought about before. If we're talking about putting a reaction together and looking at rates of reaction, you can actually demonstrate that with this. You can use it in lecture and not just in lab. Okay, so that's pretty much what I have to say. Thanks very much.
Great. Thank you, Peter. That was very cool, very insightful. Just a quick reminder, we'll move forward with our agenda. We're super grateful to our guest speakers. We're going to next hear from Dr. Brian Woodfield, who's one of the co-founders at Beyond Labs. And then after that, we'll take a little bit of time for some questions. So we'll turn the time to Dr. Woodfield.
That was really awesome. I mean, so you have to remember, I've been dreaming about these labs and how they're used for 20 years. And to see Ashley and Peter and how they've taken, you know, the basic premises of what we did for the labs and actually used them, it just makes my heart feel really warm inside. I mean, I'm not an organic chemist. The organic lab I developed in collaboration with my colleague at BYU, Merritt Andrus. And so he's the organicer. So, you know, I just kind of executed some of the ideas that he had, but it's really great to see it's used. And I think for those who are maybe, I know there's a mix of the attendees. Some have been using the labs and some have not. And, you know, what you've just seen is really the basic premise of the labs that we did, is that we never intended to make these labs so that they're lab replacements. They've always been intended to be tools that we add to our curriculum, whether it's in the lab or it's in the lecture, to get students to think like chemists, to think like a scientist, and to get them engaged and to get them doing things rather than just passive sit on their seats types of listeners. So it's really great to see all of these examples. I think maybe what I have to share is quite different. You know, my what I've been asked to do is kind of give a sneak peek into what we're coming with that's going to be released in August 1st. So we've been actively, let me share my screen here. So for those who are new, this is our current portal. And so these are our products. Ashley was showing the general chemistry. Peter was showing the organic chemistry. We have biology and physics and physical science. And what these are collections of these different lab benches. And they're locally installed. And we also have all of our activities that we've already, these are meant to be drop-ins, they're flexible, we have different levels, there's general chemistry, thermodynamics, we have all of this different content. We also have this content, instead of a PDF, in a digital format that can be integrated into your LMS system. So what we're doing now, and what we will have ready for August 1st, is we are actively converting our general chemistry and organic chemistry into an HTML product so that you no longer have to worry about Chromebooks, you no longer have to worry about installations. It'll work much more generally. Biology and physics will be next. They will still exist and be available as a standalone locally installed product, but our portal will change. But the basic premise is labs and activities, and our new portal will give access to all of our digital content. But of course, like Ashley and Peter have shown, you can modify and write your own content. So I kind of want to just show you where we're at on new labs. And so I've kind of, we're pretty much nearing the end of our development for the 5 general chemistry labs. So if you're familiar with the labs, the lab itself is unchanged. They're going to work the same way. the things that we're adding are over here, or what we call in our tray. So we're adding a tray, and it's going to have a lot of new functionality. So this is our inorganic lab, if you're familiar. And, you know, again, works the same way. I grab an empty test tube, you see what's in it. I could go add these cations. And so that's all works the same. I can divide it. I can go add my chemicals, centrifuge, I can decant. I can come over here and do flame tests. But the nice thing is that now we're adding this functionality to really make it easier to sync into what we do and what you do in the lab. So here is a flame test, and I can save this. And what we're doing is we're saving all of these images now into this lab book. So we're integrating our lab book, and we had a lab book before, but the students could modify. It was pretty easy to cheat with it. So now this lab book is going to get saved on a server, and it's immutable. They can enter their notes. So I can come down here and say, I am a good chemist, and add that text down here. And it's part of the lab book, but now they can't change it. And now you're going to be able to, in our new platform, in our new portal, you'll be able to see all of your student lab books all in one spot and be able to save that issue. So the other thing that we're adding here is we can come over here and now save our lab configuration. So we could do that before as well, except we really didn't surface it, and it was a local file that you had to move around. Now you can change those labs. So if I clear my lab here and come to my presets tab, everybody can have their own set of custom presets. So if I click here, I've now regenerated this lab. But the really powerful thing here is that we can do things with practice unknowns. So here's a practice unknown. I come over here to unknowns, go to practice. So now they can go over here, do the chemistry, and I know I have cobalt. So I'll reveal, and shows me what this. So this is purely for practice. But you will also be able to do assignments. So in this portal for the instructors, you'll be able to go do a practice on an assigned unknown. So here's one that I've already created, and it's a custom one of my own presets, but you'll be able to make these available to your students. And so here's one. And now if you go back to unknowns, notice there's a little red dot saying, hey, you're supposed to do something. Come down here. Now they need to report what they have. They can click what they have, and they click submit, and they see their answers. And they're going to say, well, now they can cheat, but they can't, because the student will always get the same random unknown. And then when you go to the lab book, and when they submit, this gets time stamped and recorded in their lab book, so that you can go through, you or your TAs can go through their lab books and actually grade these results. So the really big new features here are presets that you can now use. You'll be able to share. So if I go back to these presets, you'll be able to copy these links that you have and maybe send out. It's just going to be an HTML link that they can share with your students. They can click on the link, and then it will automatically launch the lab with the preset that you want. And again, you'll have other options. So for example, if I come over here to my titrations lab, the kind of options you'll be able to have, for example, is here's an HCl, here's sodium hydroxide. Again, this works the same. We're showing, instead of having external windows, we're showing all of our data in our live data tray here. So here's my pH, here's my conductivity meter. I can come over here, add a beaker. I'm just gonna go add some HCl a little bit, and go add thymal blue, you know, turn on my stirring. The nice thing here is you'll be able to, in these assignments, so not only will you be able to create practice unknowns, so I can come over here and create practice unknowns for them to play with, but you'll be able to do assigned unknowns and then control what kind of tools they have in the lab. So you'll be able to turn off the indicators or turn off the pH meter, turn off the conductivity meter, and force them into doing the titration in certain configurations. If I come back here to live data, I can come over here, start doing this. Let's go a little bit faster. I can save my data. I can come over here and turn on my graph so I can monitor what's going on. So let's go a little faster here. And so here's your graphs. I can save this graph to my lab book. So you'll have this power now that you didn't have in the old labs to really configure what the lab does. So I'll just stop this right now, interest of time, stop saving my data, come back over here to my lab book. So here's the graph, here's the data. You'll be able to copy this data and have them analyze it externally. And again, this is going to be a complete record of what the student does, when they open, when they close, timestamps, so they can't cheat. You'll be able to also, if you don't want to use our system to look at the lab book, you can also do a export to PDF and export that lab book so you can submit them in other ways. So we have all of our labs are pretty much done. Here's a coffee cup. Here's my live data. I've been collecting data for a while here. And you know, notice that we've moved our stock rooms over here into the tray just so it's easier. You know, here's a metal. I can go add gold, come down here, and this part's really much the same as the old lab. So there's my mass, open my oven, put this in, and close it. Now I'm at it over here and go in, go back to live data. Now you can see my temperature increase. Again, I can click here and save my lab, go to the lab book, see this. And all of this lab book will be saved on servers. Presets will be servers, so I'll be able to share them, have global presets. So if you're used to certain functionality in the lab, it'll be there. But really, this is how we're changing it. I do want to add, show you a really nice addition that we're doing in quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics, atomic theory lab, remember we could do, so this is a classic experiment where we took metal, we did gold, and I'll go to my source here and do alpha particles, come over here to my detector, and I'll pick my phosphor screen. So put my alpha particles, put my gold. So we'll have these standard things here. And so turn on my detector, come over here to my phosphor screen and turn on my alpha particle. So you notice we've changed a little bit where we control things and quantum mechanics, it's over here. And so I'm still reproducing. So we have all of those really nice classic experiments that we did before. So I can go into persist mode, save where they go. I can save this to the lab book. And so we have that, but here's the one thing that we've missed that a lot of customers have really requested that we have is the ability to do kinetics. And so we have added the ability to do kinetics now in quantum mechanics. So what I can do here is I'm going to come here and select my spectrometer. That's the wrong one. I want to come here and pick liquids. And now part of our liquids that we're doing is we have crystal violet with different OH minus concentrations. So I can pick a crystal violet, which has now been added. And then I'm going to go pick a super light bulb. But of course, we'll be able to do presets so we can preset this all up, or you can preset the lab into whatever form you want. So like Peter was saying, teach them how to design the experiment, or maybe you design it for them and have them kind of execute it. But here is our spectrometer. So now we're going to turn on our light bulb. And so now you get to see the spectrum for crystal violet, but you'll notice here that our peaks are changing. So this is reacting. Crystal violet is decomposing here. And so this peak is changing. So what you can do is several ways of collecting data. You can take a laser and dial in and look at a specific absorbance at one wavelength, or you can just come over here and do screen captures into the lab book at set time intervals, analyze this peak, get the data out, analyze it to show the, and have them calculate the rate constants, the rate order for crystal violet and for OH minus. So I know we're running out of time and need to have some questions. So I know for the organicers among us, we are actually next week going to start the development of organic. It will be ready by August 1st for sure. These are the mockups, just so you can see kind of things, how we're changing. So you same functionality, we're just changing that stock room. We're moving it over here so that solvents are up there. So you'll be able to pick the different categories, pick your solvents, pick the different reagents, bring them out to the lab. We'll have our spectral libraries going to move over here. We are also going to, there's where you can pick the different spectra and display them in Windows. We're also going to move our live data where all those displays come, so you can save them here, save them to the lab book, zoom in, so your live data becomes a record of that session. And the cool feature we're going to add here is we're adding a kind of a tutorial to introduce them to the different equipment, so that you can pick on the equipment on the chalkboard, pick FTIR, point to where it is, give a little instructions on how to use it. And same thing over here in the qualitative analysis that Peter described is we're just going to move it over here. And the really nice thing is you get the practice unknowns here, the practice knowns, so that they know what it is, but they get it unknowns. And we're going to report those unknowns. And video shows up here in live data. You can save that to their lab book. And you're also going to be able to control whether this is visible to the student. You'll be able to control if spectra is available to the student. And here's how you're going to be able to report those unknowns. Is over here in their unknowns category, be able to report them, and it goes into their lab book. So anyway, that's my brief tour, kind of high level brief tour of how it's going. So if you're used to it, it's going to be the same, but we're going to add some really nice features that make it easier for you to do stuff and to control cheating.
Great. Thank you, Brian, for that. Couple things. We just have a couple minutes. We'll open to questions here in a second. We will be sending out a survey to all of you who are attending today via email. If you would like access to the beta version of the labs, as Brian just showed them, please fill out the survey and there will be an option there to request early access for that. So that's that. For questions, we're going to go ahead and what we'll do is if you have a question you would like to address, you can either address it to the Beyond Labs team or to Peter or Ashley. If you would, just at the beginning of your question, just say who you're speaking to, who the question's for. The format on your little Zoom bar at the bottom, you have a raise hand option. If you'll raise your hand, someone from our team will unmute you and give you the opportunity to verbally ask your question directly to who it is. You're welcome to continue to post questions in the chat or the Q&A if you would like to. And we'll do that for just the last couple of minutes here.
Maybe we just described it so well, there's no questions.
Hi there, can you hear me?
Yep, go ahead.
So I am a physics lab coordinator, so just asking because I didn't hear a lot about the physics side, although I was really interested in the quantum simulation because we do have a quantum mechanics lab. Just wondering at the lower level, and I'm going to start playing with your demo next month, Are there ways to, I think, have a lot of exploration? I'm less concerned about what results students have as opposed to, you know, how they got there. And we really focus on assessing uncertainties in our program. So I saw maybe some of the analogous with how you could set up the lab bench and put in possible mistakes. Maybe you could just speak to what type of things we could do on the physics side.
Sure, I'd be glad to do that. So physics will still be available. It'll just be in the local installed version. We were kind of focusing on chemistry today, but we have a webinar and in a couple of minutes, or we have webinars every Tuesday and Friday that are more free form than this, where we just demo and answer questions. And so Heather or somebody can provide a link to those webinars where we'd be glad to show you the physics lab in detail to talk about that uncertainty. Indeed, the entire purpose of the lab is it's to be able to have that flexibility to control it so that you can really focus things for the students when they're beginning and then pull that structure away so you're completely unstructured at some point, just like Peter kind of progressed his students in organic chemistry all the way through. So the physics labs has mechanics, solar system, optics, circuits, density, and we pull in the quantum mechanics, calorimetry, and the quantum mechanics, calorimetry, and from the chemistry labs as part of the physics package. And so all of those are together so that you can explore those topics. So we'd be glad to show you. Heather can do it. Any of us can kind of show you the physics labs. One thing I'd also add, since you mentioned about uncertainty and errors, is like in our labs, like in the titration lab and the calorimetry lab, we build in real errors into it. So there's natural uncertainty in the different types of measurements. Like if you use a graduated cylinder versus a pipette, you get different accuracies and reproducibilities on those delivery mechanisms for volumes. The balance has built in buoyancy errors. And so we're really big on that as well, to teach students that life isn't always exactly reproducible and you need to deal with it.
Thank you. And I do see the link for the other webinars. I appreciate that. So I'll follow up that way.
Good. That'll be great. We'd love to do that.
Okay, great. Thanks, Brian. Yeah, it looks like we're done with the questions. So again, we want to thank our guest speakers, Peter and Asha. They did awesome. It was great. It is really fairly fulfilling for our team to be able to see sort of real instructors using this with their students. It's pretty cool. So we appreciate that. We appreciate your time. Please look for the email that you'll be getting with the survey that will allow you to have answer some questions for us if you could, and then also get access to a beta version of the new software. We did record this webinar, so we will have it available if you have colleagues who would be interested in seeing it. And I think the team has posted ways to get in touch with us for sales and pricing and other things. And so I think that's all we have for you. Thank you for coming. We really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, everybody. We really appreciate you attending.
Thank you so much, Peter and Ashley.
Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.